Sunday is next on Channel 4 KNBC Los Angeles.
Welcome to the Sunday program, and it's a very special day for us because today, instead of being on location in some exotic spot around Southern California, we are for the first time right here at home base at KNBC in beautiful Burbank.
And why is that?
The reason is because KNBC is celebrating its 25th anniversary of serving the community of Southern California.
Yeah, you know what, Kelly? In those 25 years, the television industry has changed a great deal. Thousands of programs have been produced at NBC and at KNBC, and we're going to take a little tour today, and in the process of doing that, we are going to talk to some of the really big stars and some of the people that have been responsible for these programs the past 25 years.
Yes, we are. And we're going to tour around the building. We will see set construction, we'll see wardrobe, we'll see makeup, we'll go up and visit the newsroom and see what's going on up there. In other words, we will take a tour all around the KNBC facility today.
Yeah, I think a lot of people, when they watch television, aren't really sure how all that happens, and we're going to do our darndest to try to show you how it happens today. So are you ready?
I certainly am. Got your ticket?
I got mine. I'll buy yours on the way.
Let's go.
A new car is just one of a thousand things that Coast Federal's Insiders Club can help you get at special low insiders prices, or my name isn't Art Linkletter. Now, to become a member of the Insiders Club, just open an account for $1,000 at Coast Federal Savings, where your money receives the highest interest rates in Coast's history, and where you enjoy the convenience of over 20 locations, Saturday service, and lots of other extras. At Coast Federal, we want your money. And we'll do more for it.
Sometimes the world gets to be just a little too much. That's why KPOL Radio plays music dividends, hundreds of full hours of beautiful music without commercial intermissions. And if you really want to make the world go away, KPOL will give you a chance to win a vacation to Tahiti or a cruise to Mexico. How? Listen and make the world go away.
I'm Henry Block, president of H&R Block, the income tax people, with more of my 17 reasons why you should let us prepare your taxes. Number three, we take all the time we need when it comes to preparing your return. We conduct in-depth interviews to make sure we understand your personal tax situation, and we keep all information completely confidential. Number eight, H&R Block is a year-round service. We do not disappear after April 15th. Number 12, we have had years of experience. Our people have been specially trained. We'll do the best possible job in preparing your return, and then we'll carefully check it for accuracy. Number 16, we'll try to do everything we can to save you money. After all, we want your business again next year.
This is the scenic construction department.
Yes,
where
it
we
is.
Build all the sets here at KNBC, and we have about 75 carpenters that work a lot of times around the clock.
That many?
Yeah.
I wonder, do they make the potted plants here too? Or?
No, nothing is ever potted here at KNBC. Oh,
well, not that we know of anyway.
That's right. Or that we would tell about.
I bet you didn't know something. I bet you didn't know that most of these sets are built on wheels. You know why?
Why?
Well, because they have to take them from studio to studio. If you want to go from studio one to three, you can't carry it. You got to wheel it.
That's true. And, of course, they always look a whole lot better on television
than
they do sitting here, because television has a telescopic effect and they appear a lot smaller, so you don't see all the little
flaws and hammer holes and all that. Matter of fact, people come into the newsroom and look at our news set, and they always say, gee, it's much bigger than I thought, because television makes things look smaller.
But sometimes they say that to us, too. You guys are much bigger than I thought.
This is a set of a patio, huh? Like, it kind of looks that way.
Yeah, I think this is...
Fellas, they're trying to tell us something.
I think it's going over the days of our lives. Oh. One of our carpenters.
Art Linkletter, I've heard of trying to climb up the ladder of life, but this is ridiculous. What are you doing?
Well, you got a coffee break?
I was just sitting back there waiting for People Are Funny to start again.
And we were so funny that we had to do it three or four times.
As a matter of fact, NBC would sort of like to start People Are Funny again, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Well, after 19 years, I'd kind of like to try it again myself under a different set of rules.
What was the matter with the old rules?
Well, I think times have changed and conditions have changed and audiences have changed, but basically people are funny and they'll always be funny. You know that.
Did you used to use sets? I know you did a lot of your stuff outside and used real places.
Mostly we concentrated on people and we sent them out to perpetrate all kinds of horrendous things on the neighborhood.
Right.
Nice
but
guy.
We had sets. We did build sets when we had elaborate indoor stunts on the stage, and I'll never forget one where we were having the strongest man in the world attempt to lift an elephant.
Oh, really?
And he was going to lift it live, and he was going to do it by crawling under a scaffolding on which the elephant had walked up, and then underneath it he would lift the entire scaffolding and the elephant all at once. And the set had to be built just right so that the elephant would have the strength, but it would not be too heavy and add to the
elephant's weight.
And would
not fall on the guy.
And it wouldn't fall.
Oh, my gosh.
So when the man started to straighten up underneath this mass of scaffolding and the elephant, everything began to shake a little, and the elephant became skitterish and nervous. I don't know whether you know what elephants do.
I'm beginning to get the message.
When they get skitterish and nervous. But this elephant did it, and did it as no other elephant in history has ever done it. And I must say that the man underneath the scaffolding did turn out to be the strongest man in the world.
For a long time?
Oh, for weeks.
What are some of the gags that you guys did outside?
Oh, of course, we used animals a lot. We sent people out to call on neighborhood people with llamas and with camels and with skunks. And we did a lot of con stunt. Everybody is interested in the con man game. As a matter of fact, they're making movies about it now.
Yeah. Sure.
And we had guests go out and pretend that they were racetrack touts with electrically wired saddles for fixed races. We had people going from door to door selling $5,000 mink coats for $20. And of course, they were turned down.
Yellow pictures. Oh, right. Nobody.
And we had people distributing money. We had people delivering packages, for instance, to the top floor of the Broadway Hollywood department store at a crowded hour. And the package was actually a completely inflatable lifeboat. And our man, Irv Atkins, would be alongside, and by the time he got in an elevator with 10 people, he'd surreptitiously pull the guy's tab, and the thing would start growing. These kind of things.
Well, if you weren't in this business, then you probably might have been in jail or in Alcatraz or something.
Oh, easily. I think anybody in television who wasn't in this business would either be in the funny farm or in jail.
We may all end up there. Yeah,
did you ever get arrested? Did any of you people ever really, did you have to bail anybody out ever?
We generally had cops at places nearby where we thought a riot might occur. But quite often, the riot would happen in some other direction, and the cop would be left watching the wrong exit.
Yeah.
For instance, at a football game, we had a contestant run out, as you've often seen drunks run out in football games. We had this man run out into the field to do something, grab the ball, and our cops were all on this side to see that he was protected. Well, the cops on the other side who weren't in on the stunt, they beat our cops to the center of the field and dragged this guy off to jail.
And you had to bail him out, right?
Sure.
Well, in other words, you made some people mad in the course of these events, certainly, I'm sure.
Mad?
Yeah.
We were sued. We had constant insurance claims against Lloyd's of London for all kinds of things, invasion of privacy, people being startled out of their wits. After all, you know, we did everything in 19 years. That you can dream
of. Do you think that Kel mentioned bringing it back? Do you think it'd work today, Art?
I think People Are Funny would work with a slightly different set of ground rules. We would have to do fewer of what I call the broad burlesque stunts with the pies and the seltzer water and the men wearing ladies' hats and those kind of things, which 30 years ago were quite fresh.
Sure.
And do fewer of those.
Because people have seen
people are more sophisticated. Yeah. People have seen it all. And we'd have to do more of the real human interest, in-depth stunts, which people are still just as interested in. For instance, can you be hypnotized, really? And if you are, what stupid and silly thing can you do? That's still fascinating.
Sure.
And we had a woman hypnotized, and she was told that she would meet a man, that she, next time she saw him, she'd want to kiss him. And she was a school teacher, a spinster school teacher. So then we sent the man back in the audience. We brought the lady out of her hypnotic trance and sent her up the aisle on some goose chase that had nothing to do with what we'd set up. And as she passed this man, she suddenly stopped and looked at him. And there was a long pause. And a silly look came over her face. She says, I want to kiss him. She says, I can't. I said, well, why don't you go ahead and do it? She says, oh, I couldn't. I'm a school teacher. And and she kissed him. And to a great, just couldn't keep from kissing. Those kind of stunts are still fascinating to everybody.
Sure, yeah. Because people are people. Here we sit in scenic construction, and you people made the transition from radio to television, and where you had to use sets and where you all of a sudden were visual. Was that a hard thing to do?
Strangely enough, we looked forward to it.
Sure.
For many years on radio, we were doing these elaborate visual stunts, and I was describing them. And the people were describing what had happened to them outside. And we dreamed of the days when television would let us picture it, and then arrive television. And of course, as you can guess, anticipation is always greater than realization. And when we actually shot the stunts, if people didn't react with great excitement and joy when we gave them a car, and often they didn't, they'd say, thank you. Or when we sent a man or a lady up Hollywood Boulevard with a leash on the end of which was a live skunk, and everybody would, in radio, be picturing people running and frightened and everything.
Right.
On Hollywood Boulevard, what's a skunk? Nobody even gave it a second
That's a
look.
A lot of skunks.
So we had problems.
Yeah.
And as you all will recall, dear old Jack Benny, when he had his bank vault in his house in days of radio,
right.
And then they did it in television.
Right.
Well, it never was as good for me as I had pictured it
from
the word pictures.
Yeah. Art Linkletter, thank you very much. An integral part of the last 25 years of NBC, and maybe the next 25 too, huh?
Well, I don't know. I'll call my partner John Goodell and see if we're ready to start it again.
Okay. Thanks a lot. We're going to go over now to the place we call Special Effects and talk with a gentleman, Steve Allen.
At last, here's the great hits made famous by the King, Elvis, combined for the first time on these two incredible RCA albums and available only by mail through this special TV offer. You get Don't Be Cruel.
Don't Be Cruel.
Remember the beautiful Love Me Tender?
Love Me Tender.
And of course, Jailhouse Rock.
You should have heard you knocked out.
Return to Sender. All Shook Up. Teddy Bear. And the beautiful...
But I...
If you send now, you'll get all these hits and so many more. Elvis, his great hits, two fantastic RCA albums, yours for the amazing low price of just $4.98, only by mail. Send for yours now.
Mail $4.98 for record, $6.98 for tape to Hound Dog, Box 1338, Burbank. You get these two exclusive albums for this one low price. So you don't forget, send before midnight tomorrow, $4.98 for records, $6.98 for tape to Hound Dog, Box 1338, Burbank.
Okay, Stouffer's, here I come.
Even if you follow the ingredients on the Stouffer's package, you still won't be able to match Stouffer's frozen French crumb cakes. That crumb cake taste you've come to love. That's a secret Stouffer's will never reveal to anyone.
Oh, see, I told you. No one makes French crumb cakes as good as Stouffer's.
Here's the new easy way to clean, condition, and protect all your fine leathers and vinyls. It's the tannery. Safe to use, just spray it on and wipe dirt off. The tannery helps put new life in leather or vinyl, chairs, sofas, luggage, shoes, purses, even vinyl car tops and interiors. Won't dull, dry out, or crack leathers and vinyls like detergents and water can. The tannery cleans, conditions any color in seconds. You'll find the tannery in your store with polishes and cleaners.
Okay, well,
it's only us, folks.
It's only us, the Three Musketeers. What you've just seen there is a special effect, and that is supposed to be fog, and it's done by a little dry ice and some hot water.
Paul, I've seen effects, and I don't think that one's so special.
Ruined my hair. You know, they're using, as Paul said, the dry ice and hot water. They used to use acid, but now you live through it.
Yes.
The hot water.
To help us explain all this and to talk about it, we have Steve Allen, who is kind of a special effect. He's a very special comedian. He has an effect on people. I don't know what it is, but he'll be with us today to talk about television and all those kind of things. Special effects include a lot of things, not only the fog that we just saw, but I guess they have the furniture when you get in fights and you break it over people's heads, and it's made out of balsa wood.
Oh, yes. Very often, you know, if you're seeing a Western or a scene where a man stands in front of a monitor like that chap right there, you'll immediately notice that some vicious character will pick up a bottle and or cause a feedback.
That was a special effect. That's
or anything of that sort.
Time.
And attack someone with it. And imagine hitting yourself with a bottle. Like that.
Why, you?
Now, I didn't get hurt, but a piece went in your eye, right?
Yes. And I won't stand for that, sir.
Oh, well.
Now, listen here. That's
a wait a minute.
That's for you and one for you, too. And
listen, anybody would wear a tie like that. I wouldn't.
I got news for you. I've only got two of these, and as a matter of fact, I'm going to eat one of them right here in front of everybody else.
You lost
he's
an election
his tie. Bet.
That's it. There goes the tie.
Well, it's
if
Lord.
He's going to eat his tie. I hope to be able to eat my hat.
We're having trouble with our cook. You know, it's hard to get help these days. Yeah.
It's not well done enough.
Little did I know, this is the best part.
You did the Tonight Show way back, 1954,
55, and 56.
56, and then had your own show for a while, didn't you, after that?
I did a comedy show after the Tonight Show, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As a matter of fact, we're wandering through celebrating our 25th anniversary at KNBC, and it is your 25th anniversary, too, in the biz, because we saw just last Wednesday night a big special celebrating said fact.
Yes, the building here and I are sharing the same celebration, in a sense, because my first television venture was here on KNBC in 1948. It was a perfectly atrocious program called Country Store. We did it in the city, unfortunately.
That was where the studios were, I think, in Hollywood then, weren't they?
Yes, at Sunset and Vine.
Hollywood. KNBH, 1940. Started in 1948.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then became, what was it, KRCA, I think, in 1954, and then KNBC in 1962.
Mm-hmm.
Where has television gone in those years? I mean,
it was here a minute ago.
Well, I know it's still here.
Hey, you guys see what television went? Stand by for a minute.
We'll find it.
But I mean, in the early, come on, bear
listen,
with me.
I don't feel so good.
In the early days, it was more of an ad lib situation, wasn't it? More of a spontaneous type thing, and now it's kind of
well, there. When in the days when we were all on live, which means not tape, you know, when you were doing it, you were being seen. There had to be a bit more ad libbing then because they didn't have time enough to get all the scripts ready. But the talk shows, the Tonight-type shows, Merv and all those shows, they're still pretty much the same as they were when I did them in the 50s, and that almost all of them are ad-lib. But what is lost now is that wonderful feeling of dandruff.
I got the forecast wrong again. I never said anything about snow in Southern California, and I want to apologize about that.
A special effect. Well,
this is rather typical of the old days, and that's why we're in the new days now.
You really shouldn't fool with Mother Nature. She'll do it to you every time. Hey, you're talking about the live show that you used to do, live as opposed to now that all of us are half dead.
Oh, hold the snow, guys.
Hold the snow, man.
Let's take a look at a film clip that we have of yours that goes way back, I think, some 15 years ago.
Ooh, all right.
Okay, of the Steve Allen Show.
And here it comes.
At this time.
Right now, on your set.
That's it, you're seeing it.
This fellow, as you can see, his real Hawaiian blood. He has a little bottle of it upstairs, I think. Yes. And that, no, really, this is our own Floyd Bridges on the vocal. Thank you, Floyd.
You're welcome, Marvin.
We just...
What was that?
I was, as they say in America, nothing. We discovered Floyd. Actually, we discovered this young fellow in Tahiti, where he was doing some sponge diving, right? He was in a dive sponging for drinks. And now, I'd like to tell you about a few of our latest record albums. We're very proud of these, and of course, all of them feature our new jerky jungle sounds. And this one here, we recorded in the mouth of the volcano Mauna Loa while it was erupting. It's called Music for Swinging Lavas. And the next one, you got to pay attention here, boy. This is an album in which we got a fabulous and very original sound by hitting tropical birds with a mattress. It's called Parrots in the Spring, right? We really beat them up. And this one here, the third one, features the sound of 3,000 chimpanzees, orangutans, marmosets, and baboons. It's called Music to Go Ape By.
That's embarrassing.
Yes.
You silly thing.
You silly twerp, you.
Are you all right? Can we get your breath?
No, I'm fine. I'm as fine as I can be at my age.
You make up all this stuff yourself, or do you?
No. On a show of that sort, that was the old our old Sunday show with that was Bill Danes. I'm sure everyone recognized.
Sure.
We had in the background Don Knotts and Louie Nye and all the gang. We were doing a takeoff on Don Ho type Hawaiian bands. And on that kind of a show, like, the Dean Martin show or the Carol Burnett show, you have 6, 7, 8, 9 writers, as many as you can afford. Yeah. Nobody ad-libs a whole hour of comedy specials.
We were up watching you on the monitor there. You were watching, too. Do you get a kick out of watching yourself, or would you rather not?
It depends.
If I'm
watching something that was good, yeah, I get a kick out of that. If I watch something that was terrible, I hardly could be expected to.
Do you always know? Could you have that inner thing that you know when it dies, or you
know? Usually, you know while it's happening. Yes.
And there's no way you can save it.
It could be happening right now. You know.
In that day, that show was on the air live, and therefore, whatever happened, for better or for worse, there it was. Nowadays, there's a lot of dying that goes on in the studio that the people at home never see, mm-hmm. because we edit the tape.
Sure.
You can add recorded sound effects of people who laughed 14 years ago at a Bob Hope show or something and put them on your show. And so it's very difficult now to die. So that today, when you see a rotten program, it is really rotten.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Because they tried for 3 weeks to make it better, and they couldn't. You know?
Is that a terrible feeling when you know it's going right down the pipes? Because we do the Sunday show live a lot of times, too, and you know that you can't save it.
You
can't pull it out of the fire. And the more you try, the worse it gets.
A program of this sort really cannot die or bomb the way a comedy program can. Because...
Yes, it can.
Yes, it can.
I don't think so. No, this program can never really get lousy. You know, whatever your worst show was, this is a good show, but whatever your worst show was, it really wasn't lousy. It was just maybe 14% less good than your best show, you know. But when you're doing a comedy program, or for that matter, if you're standing in front of an audience doing a comedy monologue, and things are not going well, it can just get terrible, and everybody sees how terrible it is, because they expect a laugh after every sentence, and if there is silence, or if the sentences are no good, the failure is immediately apparent. Whereas a talk show, let's say like a Tonight Show, so that we don't embarrass you by just talking about your program, a Tonight-type show...
Can be lousy, too, right?
Well, it can be less good on certain nights, but it can never really get terrible, you know? Because the audience's expectations are different.
But how do you... Your
there we go again. I stepped on a
Well,
again,
we got just so much time.
You go right ahead. Get
okay.
The snow off your head.
How much... How often... now, see, I forget what I was going to say.
How often do you forget what you're going to say?
Oh, very, very
we just
often.
Did.
No. How do you psych yourself up for comedy? Do you ever go out there and just feel very unfunny because you've had a lousy day and you got a ticket and you don't feel like being funny? What do you do to get
it
going?
No, I don't have that problem. First of all, how funny I am is for an audience to decide or an individual viewer. But I am able to feel silly quite handily because it's as long seemed to me that I live on a peculiar planet. And everything about this planet seems to me partly ridiculous. And if I just stop and think about that for a minute, I feel silly or funny, and something of that feeling on my part is communicated to an audience, I suppose.
We noticed that you live there, and we're going to have to start taxing you up there, too.
Whatever.
Who makes you laugh? Who's your favorite guy?
I'm a notorious pushover for other comedians. I laugh at almost all of them. There are just about 3 or 4 in the business that, for whatever reasons, don't amuse me. Would not mention their names, of course.
Oh, come on. No, better not.
But I laugh at all the rest, about 98% of them. I laugh at my children. I laugh at my dogs. I really do laugh all day long.
Do you laugh at yourself, Steve?
Yes, yeah.
Which is a very important commodity in this business. I think we'd all go,
it sure helps. But everything can be looked at in another way, and perhaps dozens of other ways than we are accustomed to looking at it. For example, there are many people right now, you have hundreds and thousands, maybe millions of viewers to the show on Sunday afternoon. A lot of people were not here when we started this conversation. They came into the houses or got up out of bed or whatever.
Right. Nice to see
and
you.
And right now, some of them have just turned on their set, and they're saying things like, I didn't realize Steve Allen was getting gray.
Or had all that dandruff.
Right, I've heard about a dandruff problem, but that, man, this is ridiculous.
It must be a commercial deal they're doing.
Could be.
Or they're saying, gee, you know, Paul Moyer looks pretty heavy on the air, but really he's not, he's a skinny guy. You know, the cameras, I guess, do things to us, and the people us, they see us from here up.
Mm-hmm.
And they see Kel or myself or whoever on the street, and they say, you don't look like you, you know, because you just come over from here up. That's all they see.
Yes, you should know at home, although it will not be the most important news you ever heard, that camera lenses, TV camera lenses, take whatever they are showing and split it sideways a little bit. Now, for automobiles, that's marvelous, because it makes them look about a foot and a half longer than they really are. But for human heads, it's rather terrible. And I am constantly being told by people who are just meeting me for the first time, oh, you're a tall, rather slender fellow. I always thought you were little and fat. The reason they thought I was little is that everybody is about a foot high on television. I'm, in fact, 6'3". And the reason they thought I was fat is because this thing, my head or my face, goes like that. So I'm really not this fat.
Terrifying.
I'm not skinny either, but I'm not that fat.
Television cameras put on 15 pounds. That's why you shouldn't eat them.
On all of us.
What's coming up for Steve Allen? What are you doing?
Well, I just did the comedy special. Yeah. You mentioned it was on last Wednesday, and I've done another comedy special for, as we say, another network, which will be on February 14th.
The Dumont, or DuPont, or whatever it is.
The guys across the street.
Okay. Listen. We'd like to thank you for being here. And
we'll go right ahead.
Before you go, thank you for being here. Before you go, a special effect right in the knee. That's it.
And here's your lid. Thanks a lot,
all right,
Stevie.
And if this isn't very weird, I'll eat my hat.
Okay.
And I'll eat my tie.
We're going to go somewhere else, aren't we?
I hope
dust
so.
Dust ourselves off and see what else we can find here at KNBC
special
as we
effects.
Celebrate our 25th anniversary.
Jeremiah Johnson made his way into the mountains.
Robert Redford as Jeremiah Johnson.
Ever get lonesome?
Or what?
Woman?
He was given a wife.
If you value your hair, you will get married.
This weren't my idea, you know.
He borrowed a son.
Take him!
What?
Take him!
Ma'am, I wouldn't know how to tend after it.
Together, they carve their own world out of the wilderness. Jeremiah Johnson, the man who became a legend. The film destined to be a classic. Robert Redford as Jeremiah Johnson. Rated PG.
Starts Wednesday, January 23rd for 1 week only. Check your local newspaper for a theater or drive-in near you.
On the air. They've had a viewing audience of maybe 80,000 television sets.
Not a lot.
Yeah, but she's grown since then, Kel. 1974 today, KNBC from Burbank. The transmitter can reach 3.5 million homes.
That's a lot. You know, a couple of minutes ago, we were over at the set construction department, and we saw how the sets were being built. Well, now, Paul, you are in for a treat, because before your very eyes, I am about to show you how that set materializes in your very television set.
Mm-hmm. How are you going to do that?
Nothing to it. Just like this.
Hey.
You like?
Well, that's not bad. I like the place.
Wait till you see the floor show.
We got that, too. That's
you
coming
bet.
Up. All right. But you know there's something missing.
What?
There's a little something. The lighting isn't quite right.
You're right. It's a little dull.
I fix.
Okay? You can?
Sure. Watch.
Sure.
Uh-huh.
Dynamite.
Leave it for me. I did it, right?
This is a process that we call chroma key. And we're very proud of chroma key here at KNBC because it was developed here, I think, 10, 11 years ago. It was developed right here at KNBC in Burbank. And now not only us, but all over the country, people are using chroma key.
That's terrific. How does it work?
I'm sorry you asked that. You had to ask. You promised me you wouldn't. Well, technically, I don't know how it works. I can't explain it. However, we've got a guy that can explain it. He's right behind the green door, the director of the Sunday show. So I'll tell you what. You order up.
Okay.
Get the pastrami, and I'll go and ask him.
It'll be here when you get back.
Place.
And hurry back, will you? All right. Bring the sandwiches in. We'll take them now. Thank you.
Now, this is the director's booth where even as we speak, the Sunday show is being directed by our genius director, and I'll bet you wondered whatever happened to Mark Spitz. Turn around and let him see you. Hello. No, it's not really
but
the guy.
But seriously.
But seriously, folks, this is the director of our Sunday show, Julie Finkelstein. And Julie, we need you because we need you to explain technically, but not too technically, you see, how the process of chroma key works.
Okay, that's fair enough. Not too technically. It's kind of adding and subtracting from a picture. Okay, zoom into the two shot of the monitor, standby tape, roll tape. Okay, now you notice on a preset monitor, we have a picture. Now to that picture, we'll add Paul. Now take three clean. There's Paul sitting on the set. Hello, Paul.
How are you, Julie?
Okay. To that picture, we want to add a scene, a barroom scene, okay? Put it in the key. There it is.
Hey.
Now, if we want to lose Paul, we say goodbye, Paul.
Now, Julie, wait a minute.
Where's Paul? Paul's gone.
You're gone.
Is he coming back?
He'll be back. And Adam. Now, if you want to take your scene away from you, Paul, just sit you there alone. Out it goes. Now you're all alone, Paul.
Julie, not bad for the first try, I'll tell you that.
It explains it, absolutely, with no problem. It's a little of this, a little of that, and that's the way it works. Okay, Paul?
Yeah, okay. Now, you fellows, you guys have had your fun in there.
Why not, too?
I got something for you. Let me lay this number on you, and we'll see what happens.
Key in two. It's okay. Watch this.
Here it comes.
Now, that's chroma key.
But where's Paul? Paul, before you disappear entirely, let's get out of here. I'll meet you down by the computer, okay?
Okay.
This spacey place we're in now looks like it might be the set of a science fiction movie we're doing here at KNBC. However, it isn't. It's the real thing. And it's called the Central Equipment Room. It's part of a giant computerized system that is actually the brains and the pulse of all of our KNBC operations. And the gentleman that's here with us is Dick Bagdell, a man who's a technical director here at KNBC. And he knows what all of these switches and dials and knobs and lights mean. So tell us, what does this computer do, Dick?
Well, our programming has to be put on at a certain time, all the time, and all the parts of the program have to go on at a certain time. In order to get those things on at a certain time, we switch everything by computer. And incidentally, this is the clock that runs the whole thing right here.
This little baby?
Yeah.
That's the time we'll know. You can't play beat the clock. I mean, you've got to be right on.
That's
it, right?
True. We're in trouble as soon as that clock goes off. Now, let's go this way and we'll take a look in here.
You know, it's all very simple, right?
You can't bet a thousand. What happens when this this monster breaks down?
Well, when it breaks down, we can do a few things in switching central manually, get the next commercial on, you know, and from then on, we have to go upstairs.
Looks like we got a break here. Everything's hanging out. Is something wrong here?
Surprisingly, everything is in its proper location there.
That's the way it's supposed to be.
Oh,
you
yeah.
Fellas run a pretty messy shop.
Yes, we do.
No, we don't.
Not really.
If one of those wires is haywire, do you know which one it is?
We have a lot of maintenance men to go back and see that, see if they can find out what.
Where are we going here, Dick?
To go off. We're going into switching central now. This is the nerve center of the whole operation.
Aha, so this is where all you guys come in and sit down and watch television and eat your popcorn and...
Oh, sure. Now, this is where all the programming that KNBC and NBC West Coast originates, or it doesn't originate here originally, but it all goes through here. It goes to Pacific Coast and goes to KNBC, and once in a while we feed something east.
We were talking about the computer fouling up a couple of seconds ago. I see a please stand by sign there. When that happens, that's what goes up, huh?
That's what we use to let the people know there's something wrong and that's not their set generally. And we hope to have things corrected before we have to put that up, but worst comes to worst, we usually put that up.
When everybody runs around. Do you also correct the picture in here? You know, if somebody comes in looking kind of green and Johnny Carson looks a little bit ill or whatever, you fix it up?
Yes, I have the boys in tape or up in film correct it to what I think is correct.
So whatever we see on our screen is what you like?
Generally, that's true. I mean, well, we have ways of setting things up to have a certain level and so forth, but if I see it's getting off, then I have them corrected.
This is supposed to be the nerve center of it all, but it's, you know, it's really quiet in here tonight.
It is. It's very quiet, and that's why we like to keep
it. When something goes wrong, then it's a different story, right? It's pandemonium.
And all these controls are to get the building off the ground, right?
That's true. No, get all the programs off the ground correctly. That's the way it is.
Thank you very much, and we're going to run up now and leave you here to your work. And
we're going to look at one of our old haunts upstairs, huh? The newsroom.
Go up to the newsroom and see what's going on up there. Bye-bye,
right.
Dave. Thank you.
For years and years, I said my husband can't sue. But then I said to myself, you know, all I get to do is reheat it. So now I cook up Lipton soup. It really tastes fresh. First I boil the water, then I add the ingredients, then I stir and simmer. Mmm, does that smell delicious? George loves it, so do I. Lipton Italian vegetable. It isn't soup till Mother makes it.
Oleg Cassini talks about the all-new American Motors Cassini Matador.
I love this car because it was created from a fashion point of view. It has a look, with copper accents where you'd expect chrome, rich black upholstery, and thick copper carpeting. This car looks expensive, exclusive, yet it costs under $3,500. And I love this car because it's my design.
The Cassini Matador, backed by the AMC Buyer Protection Plan.
This is America.
Okay, here we are again, everybody. We are speaking to you now from a place that is very familiar to us all, at least to Kel and I it is. It is the KNBC newsroom, and we spend a little time here every day, don't we?
Yes, we do, and among all the ladies and gentlemen that you see in here, we've got three producers for the 5, the 6, and the 11 o'clock news. We've got about 20 or so writers. We've got reporters around the corner, maybe a couple of dozen of them. And all the guys that you see in the ties, those are the bosses.
Those are the bosses, yeah. And they walk around the halls with their hands in their pockets and worry a lot because we can't afford to do that. Actually, we produce 2.5 hours of local news from this newsroom every day, 5 to 6 o'clock with Jess Marlow, 6 to 7 with Tom Snyder, and 11 to 11:30 with a guy named Moyer. It takes about 120 people to do that. We have, I suppose, if not the largest, one of the largest local news operations in the United States. And these scripts don't just pop up into our hands, and these films don't just all of a sudden get edited by themselves. It takes a lot of people to do it, and it takes the whole day to do it. Paul Beavers, who produces the 5 o'clock, is in here at 8:30 or 9 o'clock in the morning, as is Jerry Hansen, who produces the 6 o'clock, and most of the writers are in at that time, too. And also down the hall, Kelly, is the headquarters for NBC Network News Bureau West Coast.
Yep.
We have somebody over here who I think you probably all know. If you don't, you should, because his name is Jess Marlow, and he anchors the 5 o'clock news service Monday through Friday on KNBC. How are you?
I put my hands in my pocket so I can be an executive.
Right, and worry a lot.
You have a tie on, so that counts.
Right. We're going to take just a couple of minutes out of your day, because I know it's getting close to that time.
You ought to, since I've been working for you all week.
I know. You have, and I appreciate that. And I picked a bad week to go on vacation. What is your day like? What time do you hit the door, and what happens after that, briefly?
Oh, I usually try to get in before noon. I got to get here in time to go to lunch. You know, so I usually try to get in.
That takes 3 hours.
Yeah, that's right. No, I try to get in before noon, but I suppose, like every reporter, your day starts really as soon as you get up in the morning, when you start going through the newspapers and the things you put aside to read. And as you say, these scripts don't just pop up, but you also have to kind of have an idea what's in them, too, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
I think it's fair to say that you present a conservative image to the public, as opposed to maybe some of our other news anchor people.
Middle class, middle of the road.
So that's right. Let's tell some of the people about the real Jess Marlow.
Whoops, we're in trouble.
What kind of a car do you drive, Jess?
I drive a Porsche.
Uh-huh. A fast car,
well,
right?
Well, it's a conservative car. It gets 24, 25 miles to the gallon.
The
if you drive
fast.
It slowly.
What's your favorite hobby? When you go on vacation, where do you usually go?
I take winter vacations like Paul because I love to ski, as you do.
Fast skis,
yeah.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
But what about your musical tastes, Jess?
Well, I'm for years was a jazz lover, but I must confess I've fallen victim to rock, probably through the influence of a college-age daughter. But I really
music?
Did, yeah.
I think there I've
goes
heard
the
you.
Image.
You've mentioned Mick Jagger,
good rock.
And, the Led
Actually,
Zeppelin. And
I kind of go, I suppose, conservative rock in terms of I love Chicago. You know,
conservative
it's
rock.
It's a nice city.
Yeah, nice group too.
Okay. Yeah.
Hey, I know you got to get back and, you know, and get going.
Somebody
and,
has to work around here.
Somebody has to do it. One interesting thing
you've
about
you've got to get to lunch, too, don't you?
Already had lunch.
Already had lunch. Ready to go. You use a teleprompter, and you type the stuff up yourself, and you can do that because you were at one time a telegrapher? A long time ago?
Yeah. Yeah, a long time ago.
And you type that stuff up in sort of abbreviation. Only you can read it.
Use a shorthand, and sometimes I have difficulty reading it, as you know.
Yeah, well, we all do that, believe me. You saw the show last week at 11 o'clock, you know that. Thanks a lot.
You bet.
Okay, good. Give him a heck. We'll see you.
Hi,
thank you, Jeff. We're going to, come on, Kel, we're going to go into the wire room, which is really where it all begins and where all the information is compiled. So let's take a look at that.
Now, this noisy place is the KNBC wire room. We've got wires, service, teletype machines, 11 of them, from United Press International and from Associated Press. We've got the trunk wires with the national news. We've got weather wire. We've got a sports wire. We've got a photo wire service that grinds out pictures every day.
We got it all.
And another fixture of the KNBC wire room is Bob Abernathy.
Standing right there by UPI.
Bob, you spend a lot of time in the wire room, don't you, Bob?
I do. Like to see what they're saying.
What is done in here, Bob? When you come in here, what do? You look at the wires, and then what happens?
I go through the city wire. I go through the AP trunk. I go through the AP regional. I go through part of the UPI, looking for what's important that's happening that day, and looking for ideas for a viewpoint or ideas for questions to ask guests who come in. And that's what everybody does here, is go through these things, hear what people phone in, hear what people tell us, and make judgments about what's important, what's interesting. This whole operation is thousands, literally thousands of judgments a day about what people would be interested in, what's important, how long to run this, whether to use that at all.
What you do, Bob, is a little different from what the rest of us do, because Paul and I and Ross and the rest of us put out news or weather or sports, but you have the luxury of saying anything that you want to on any given subject. I know that you can never please everybody all the time. As a matter of fact, I'm sure there's times when you can't please anybody, and I wonder what kind of mail, what kind of response you get from what you do.
Very reassuring. Very reassuring. You know, a lot of people call up a station like this very angry.
Oh, yes.
The mail is remarkable because it shows that even though a lot of people don't agree with what I have to say, there is nevertheless a strong, responsible, articulate, thoughtful middle of the road. A lot of people would be perhaps surprised to hear that, but that's where I think I am. And it's reassuring to find out that there are as many other people there, too.
Briefly, are your viewpoints done the same day, or do they come right off the top of the head, or do you plan them a couple of days ahead of time, or how does that work, Bob?
They're always done the same day. I've never been able to get ahead. Sometimes I get ideas. I think about it all the time, and sometimes I get an idea. I write it down on laundry cardboard that I carry around in the car. I write it down on old pieces of paper, stick them in my pocket and come in, and try to put it together, try to put ideas and quotes and feelings together with the news.
Did you ever borrow a book of matches from Bob? It's got on the back side of it. It's got all the ideas. I've seen you get together a viewpoint in about 20 minutes when something breaks and we're on the air and you change everything that you were going to do and do something else.
Writing it is not nearly as difficult as conceiving it.
Yeah.
And once I get an idea, once something happens, like, you know, somebody, you know, some major event that immediately you have some strong feeling about, that's easy. You can write that in 10 minutes. But I spend many days, most days, trying to get the idea.
Thank you very much, Bob. We're going to get out of here and go talk to Gordon Weir.
Okay. About the weather.
Okay.
All right.
Bye, Bob.
Here we go. Thank you, Robert.
Gordon Weir and I work very, very closely together, putting out the weather forecasts every day. As a matter of fact, it's been said of us that Gordon lies on the 5 and I swear to it on the 6.
And you do a good job of it.
They're always mad at us, Gordy. They call and they're mad if it rains. They're mad if we say it rains and it doesn't. Get us off the hook and tell them whose fault it really is.
I'm not sure it's anybody's fault. It's just the nature of the beast. There's no such thing as a perfect forecast. They need a scapegoat, and we're it.
Where do we get the weather, Tell?
Oh, basically from the National Weather Service, of course, and then we interpret it and use what we have time for on the air with our 2 minutes and 15 seconds.
We interpret it, right. This is the only man in town. Every other weather reporter calls, including me, and gets to talk to the PR people at the Weather Service, but he talks to the man in the ivory tower, the forecaster, and not to get the weather, because Gordy already knows what the weather is going to be. He calls to argue with them. Tell.
Well, it's not so much giving them answers as asking questions.
They say 68, and he says, well, you go for 62 in downtown. And he says, well, you settle for 64, and then they agree on that and compromise. Thank you very much. Gordy, I'll talk to you later, and we'll make up the weather. We're going to go over to Paul now, who has somebody else part of the KNBC News Service team.
Thank you, Kelly. We're talking with Brian Gumbel, a member of the KNBC Sports Department. I think we clashed today. Where do you buy your suits?
I got mine. It was a paper ad. It said $8.95 jackets.
You had to chase the guy a long way to get it, didn't you?
Marked down from $17.
You are probably one of the youngest sports announcers in these United States.
Yeah, probably so. Probably so. 25 now, Paul.
25 now.
I started when I was 23.
An old man.
Yeah.
What do you do differently on your segment than Ross Porter does at 6 o'clock?
Well, I think on the 6, Ross gives the complete sports, everything that's happening, all the scores and stories and everything else. But on the 5 o'clock, what I attempt to do is give a sports column, a feature, a satire, something out of the ordinary, just a little aspect of sports dealing more with the people than with the scores.
Yeah. You think sports is really the toy department of life?
Yeah, I guess it has to be. I think if you take it too seriously, you're in trouble.
We started together on the weekends.
Yeah, where are you working now?
If we don't shape up, we're going to be back in Fort Wayne. Thank you, Brian. We'll see you, babe.
Okay.
Hey, there's somebody I think we all know right over there.
Excuse me, sir. I notice you're standing here observing the action in the KNBC newsroom. What is it you do here?
Well, I just come in and make sure that these writers are operating. These writers haven't worked this hard since Jack Latham left about 10 years ago.
Excuse me.
Apparently, they're worrying about the next 25 years. Hello, Paul.
Am I interrupting something, guys?
Not at all, sir. What have you been doing? I've not been here while you've been here this afternoon.
Making a tour of the KNBC facility, and the newsroom is part of it. Listen, you mentioned supervising the writers, which you do, and
checking
the mail, reading it over, and coordinating production meetings. I mean, you must spend a good deal of your day right here in the newsroom, do you?
You know, it's amazing how much time I spend.
Yes, it certainly is.
How much time I spend here. No, some days I spend more time than others. Some nights when I'm leaving about 10 o'clock, I see Paul coming in for the 11 o'clock broadcast saying, where is makeup? Where is makeup? But we all spend a judicious amount of time here.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, sir.
When you supervise the writing, does that entail rewriting a lot of the scripts or just looking while the guys write it for you or what?
Not so as you would notice. People often ask the question of us, and I'm sure that you've had this question asked of you, Paul, in your capacity as a KNBC News anchorman, how much of your own copy you actually write. And the correct answer is either none of it or all of it, because we are responsible for saying all of the words that appear on a broadcast. And many a time and oft, I'm certain you, as I, will take a pencil in your hand, would you move that down just a little bit, please, and make notations on the script, which you could call rewriting, as it were. But if you ask, do I sit down at a typewriter and rewrite this copy?
The answer is
no, because it is done so professionally and perfectly the first time that it doesn't need to be rewritten. Well, not really, but we're on.
Well, Tom, I sit next to you during the news, and I can't help looking down at the script and then looking and listening to what you say, and it's very rarely the same. Can you explain that?
Oh.
Well, yes, because I don't think that we're in the business of communicating words so much as we're in the business of communicating ideas, Kelly. And to me, as I'm certain it is to Paul and to yourself, it's more important that the people understand what it is we're talking about in terms of the ideas rather than just reading the words that our writers have put down there. So that's why oftentimes the script and what we say will bear no resemblance.
So you're doing the 6 o'clock, you're doing the tomorrow show, which you tape, I think, what, 10 or 11 o'clock at night?
Exactly,
what,
Paul.
What time do you come in here? When does your day start?
About 11 o'clock in the morning most days. I'm here, but not in this room. I'm in the other side preparing for the late night show. There are many problems in putting that thing together in terms of getting people here and making sure it hangs together. So I stay over there until about 3:30 or 4, sometimes 4:30 or 5, I know, and then I come over here and get ready for the news. But with this kind of staff that we have here, a staff which incidentally has changed the face of television journalism in Los Angeles, I think, it makes the job of doing the news a lot easier.
Tom, thanks an awful lot.
Before you're through, could I say one other thing? While I realize that this program is really concerned about the last 25 years on KNBC,
I'm more concerned about how I fit into the next 25 years.
We all.
Right. And Paul, good luck on your new show. You're in good hands with this young lady and all of these people here.
I know you did it for 3 years, and, you know, we'll just give it heck and see what happens.
You're in good hands. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
May I go back to work now?
Yes, I have some writing to do.
Tom has to supervise.
Thanks, Tom. We'll see you later.
The Sunday show will continue on KNBC in a couple of minutes, so stick around.
It's not for me to say.
Johnny Mathis has a way of turning pretty tunes into beautiful songs. Beautiful songs into bestsellers.
Hello, young lovers, whoever you are. A certain smile.
And now here's a new commemorative collection from Columbia House. The Early Years, two special albums filled with Johnny Mathis' greatest hits, songs that are as enjoyable today as they were yesterday.
Look at me, I'm as helpless as a kitten up a tree. Chances are...
Yes, here are two big albums filled with the Johnny Mathis classics, now specially priced at only $6.98.
What's it all about, Alfie?
But there's more. You'll also get this third exciting album with 10 of today's most popular songs. Songs like...
The first time ever I saw...
And many more. So altogether, you get three big albums with 30 of the greatest songs ever recorded by Johnny Mathis, all for the unbelievable low price of only $6.98. Also available on 8-track cartridges for only $10.98. Here's how to order yours right now.
To order, phone Richmond 91134 or save COD charges by sending $6.98 for albums, $10.98 for tapes to Johnny Mathis, Post Office Box 53, Los Angeles, California 90053. That's $6.98 for albums, $10.98 for tapes to Johnny Mathis, Post Office Box 53, Los Angeles, California 90053, or phone Richmond 91134.
This is the wardrobe department, as you might have guessed,
yes,
and there's a lot of money tied up in these threads.
You know, it can cost, well, as much as $50,000 to put out one-hour show. I mean, for wardrobe, that's a lot of bucks for a suit.
Sure is. Here's the lady who can tell us all about it. This is Angie Jones, who's head of the wardrobe department.
Hi, Angie.
How many people do you have working here, Angie, for you?
About 60 during most of the season.
Now, when a producer comes to you and says, here's the show, Angie, dress it up, what's the process from start to finish?
Well, the producer comes with some concept of what the version is supposed to be. A designer is assigned. He then does something called sketching the show. And for instance, this is from the Andy Williams Christmas show.
Mm-hmm. Is that Claudine?
That's Claudine.
Uh-huh.
And there's the finished product.
Aha! Uh-huh. You have another one now?
Yes. This one is from Follies. And it's back there with the feather boa, which is very big this year, as you know. When
turkey feathers.
Turkey feathers.
Angie, do you reuse a lot of these costumes?
Yes.
I know you bring them back here and store them.
Yes, consistently. Yes, we reuse them often. And on Follies, we did a great deal. When you have one cast of people that work every week, then that facilitates reusing them easily.
Okay, thank you, Angie.
Thank you.
Bye-bye,
bye-bye,
Angie.
Bye-bye.
Let's go to another part of wardrobe, okay?
It's Danny Thomas.
Huh?
After all these years, you found work, pal.
Hi.
Good to see you.
Anything to make a buck.
That's what they say.
Danny, could you make me one in a size 6 in 34?
You look like a size 6. Caught in the act, eh? How are you, children?
Well, pretty good, Dad. How are you?
I'm fine. I'm an old man.
Oh, come on.
We're celebrating our 25th anniversary here at KNBC. You're the guy who brought burlesque to KNBC.
Yeah, they were fun years, the wonderful world of burlesque. Matter of fact, we did 13 specials from KNBC, for NBC. They were really fun shows to do.
A lot of people think of burlesque, they think of something dirty.
Well, that's
off
why,
color,
that's why
take
I did
your clothes
it.
Off.
That's why I did it, because... that generation, well, it was in the middle 60s, I guess, that generation and a generation, certain generation before it, had a misconception of what burlesque really was. It was burlesque later on. The old Columbia burlesque wheel had great comedians. I was 11 years old, and I was selling soda pop in the gallery of our hometown theater, the old Empire. And I saw every performance, matinee and evening, and I never saw Smart, never heard it. And there were people like Abe Reynolds, who became my theatrical patron saint. He was a Yiddish comedian, had a derby on his ears, a little goatee. He used to sing Irish songs, Swedish sonnets, Italian operas, Negro spirituals, everything in Yiddish dialect, and just fracture the people. And those guys, Sliding Billy Watson, Bozo Snyder, who never spoke a word. He was a great pantomimist. Funny situations. Never any dirt, ever, ever, ever. And I thought, you know, the young people in our country, the young marrieds and the younger ones, they ought to see what burlesque really was. And we did it, and boy, what guests we had. Everybody wanted to be on the show.
He sure did. In fact, we're going to see a little bit of what burlesque really was, a la Danny Thomas.
Just happened to happen.
We have a clip of that, I think Kim's comes from 1962, The Wonderful World of Burlesque, with Danny Thomas and surprise guest, and here it is.
Get some rest and quiet.
Show me the room.
Where's the bar in this train? Huh? This is not a train, it's a hospital room.
Don't shout, easy. Get so mad, it's okay with me. Not have to get so...
Oh, by the way, what time does this hospital room get to Philadelphia?
Will you get out of here?
There's a gorilla in the room.
Oh, nonsense.
Well, look behind you.
Oh, hello, Mr. Miller. There's absolutely nothing to get excited about. Mr. Miller is a patient in the next room.
Oh, what's he in for?
Shaving a haircut.
You know I love that stuff. No kidding. Slapstick, but I love
it. Oh, that sketch there, Jack Benny came in. Looking, he'd lost a quarter. And I said, where'd you lose it? He said, down in the basement. I said, well, why are you looking for it in here? He says, there's more light up here.
He's still doing the same bit on the rug commercial, looking for his quarter. Right.
That, of course, was taped. That was not live. But when you started, back in those days, it was live. It was live stuff.
Well, we started with NBC in 1950. Television wasn't very old then. And rest your souls, Jack Carson and Ed Wynn and Jimmy Durante and I rotated. As a matter of fact, they let me name it. I was the junior member of the organization. They said, what do we call this show? And I said, let's call it I wanted to be a star. So I said, let's call it the 4-Star Review. Yeah. And we did. We did it in the Center Theater in New York, live. And I want to tell you, pal, you people are living in luxury today.
Well, we do the news live. Of course, that's not the same.
We do the Sunday show live,
the Sunday
too, a lot
show.
Of times. And one of the few shows left that are live, and the dogs walk through the set.
People come.
Yeah, but when you're doing, you've got music, dancing, you know, what have you, and then you sketches, etc., and a time for a monologue and a closing song. And my closing song, I always ran the crawl over it, the good night thing and so forth, a la Eddie Cantor in radio, I Love to Spend, etc.
Ever have any really embarrassing moments in live television that you recall?
Oh, there are lots of them. The one that blew me sky high. I used to do a routine in the nightclubs, originally called An Ode to a Wailing Syrian. And when Lebanon became a republic, and since my heritage is Lebanese, my father insisted that I call it An Ode to a Wailing Lebanese. So, okay.
Okay, Daddy.
All right. So now I got a sheet over my head, and I'm supposed to be wailing away. Now, this routine in the nightclub ran about 18 minutes. One time around 22 minutes. And there's a couple of spots in it with absolutely dead silence. And unless you have that dead silence, you're just, this routine is going nowhere because it's so deep. And then, of course, the burlesque of it, the satirizing on all of the seriousness that you've just spoken. And the routine, I didn't want to do it. I couldn't do it in 7 minutes. And finally they said, we'll give you 9 minutes between commercials. Go ahead. So Pete Barnum, God bless him, he wanted, he was a producer, so I did it. And now I'm getting to this great dramatic moment. And I've got the camera, the middle camera, pushing in on me in this huge theater, center theater. And it was dead quiet. And the camera's pushing in on me, and my face is really getting biblical. And I'm making my point. And in the dead silence, the camera operator said, hell, I can't get it. See if Charlie can. He was talking to the guy on the phone.
Right.
And, well, and I went like this. Oh. I didn't know where to go.
It was over.
Oh, man, this is live.
Yeah.
And like the time I got out of a hobo outfit, and I had a one-minute commercial to get into white tie and tails legitimate.
The great changes, yeah.
You want to talk about wardrobe people chasing you down and grabbing your coat, tearing it off, everything. Zippers on the back of your shoes, you'd slide into the shoes. It was really something.
You know, talking about grabbers, I guess you know, but in case you don't, you brought me up with Make Room for Daddy. And us kids, we just, you remember when your wife died? Mm. Oh my gosh, my mother had to explain to us for days what happened. She didn't really die, she went on to another show, but it broke us up terribly. But everything you did on that show, you know, was...
It was real. People called me Danny Williams for the longest time, and yet it was called Make Room for Daddy. Starring Danny Thomas as Danny Williams, Jean Hagen as Margaret, his wife, and Rusty Hamer as his son, and Sherry Jackson as his daughter. And all of this billboarding, and yet Jefferson, Missouri, wherever I went, Tecumseh, Michigan, or Toledo, even my old hometown, Toledo, everywhere I went, when they'd say, could I have your autograph, Mr. Williams? And then I would write Danny Thomas. And then they would look at me for a minute and they'd say,
oh, yeah.
You're
the guy.
Oh, yeah.
You're the guy.
But Danny?
They got into it.
How do you do it? How do you stay so energetic and trim and gorgeous and tan and healthy and enthusiastic? What's your secret?
Well, number one, I hope I'm all those things, especially healthy. I'll tell you, one thing I'm against is exercise.
Really? Good. I love it so far.
I'm against physical exercise, Kelly, but I'll tell you,
No tennis, no golf.
It's all, I think, in the mind. And you don't have to be an ancient Phoenician to think that way. With me, yesterday always dies. It takes me about 36 hours to forget completely the events of the 24 hours, which was yesterday. And I learned that when I was a boy, and my mother was one of the most brilliant people the Lord ever created and couldn't write her own name in any language. She was what society refers to as an illiterate, but she was brilliant. And she just knew I was having a problem. And she said to me, my boy, if you get in the habit of carrying yesterday on your back, you'll be hunchbacked before you're 21.
Right on. Mm. Danny Thomas, thank you, sir.
Nice being with you.
Thank you. We'll be back in a couple of seconds.
I'd like to ask you, what do you think a 100% natural breakfast cereal would taste like?
I don't know. I've heard of it, but I've never had it.
Oh, I don't think any particular flavor at all.
I'd say bland.
No taste.
Not too tasty. Not sweet enough for me.
Not too good, but I guess they're good for you.
A little bland.
Rotten.
At best, horrible.
Bleh.
Introducing Quaker 100% natural cereal.
Quaker found the recipe that everyone else missed.
It will taste totally different. I've never tasted anything like it.
Very good.
Good, I'm glad
you're
with it.
It's pretty good.
It has a better flavor.
That's good. That's sweet.
I mean, the taste is entirely different than the flaky type of cereal.
It tastes pretty good.
It's tasty and it tastes good.
It's good.
What's the name of it?
Quaker 100% natural cereal.
Quaker found the recipe that everyone else missed.
Oh, it's delicious.
When you get a coffee brewer from Sparklets for your office, you can forget about black coffee and all the mess of making it. Because with a Sparklets coffee brewer, you just empty a pre-measured coffee packet into a throwaway paper filter. Then place the filter in the coffee brewer and add water. And in about 3 minutes, you get coffee that's as delicious as any you'd get in the finest restaurant. With a coffee brewer from Sparklets Water Company, the coffee in your office won't be dry anymore.
All right, everybody out of the pool and head for your TV sets. This is Bill Burritt. We'll all be looking for you on Animal World, right here on Channel 4.
Animal World, tonight at 6:30, followed by Wild Kingdom at 7.
Now, Paul, down this hall is a series of dressing rooms of some of the stars that do the big shows here. So let's kind of mosey on down.
And,
whoops!
No, what the heck? Move it out of the way. Let's go. If we get caught, we get caught. Let's give it a try.
Yeah. Incidentally, KNBC, if you notice, is doing its part for the energy crisis. We have every other light blacked out these days.
There's lights out all over the building. As a matter of fact,
yes,
the NBC Peacock isn't quite as well lit as it used to be either.
That's true.
It wasn't always that way, though. As a matter of fact, KNBC wasn't always Channel 4. In 1949, when it won the air, it was KNBH in Hollywood.
Listen, Cliff Arquette's dressing room. He's getting ready for Hollywood Square. Shall we see?
Try it.
Cliff? Hi, can we come in? You're all dressed up in your Sunday best, I'd
say. Yeah, this is my slack suit, you know. I like it.
Yeah.
I always wear my sport hat with it, you know.
The hat is beautiful. It looks like it just
you can't hardly get these ties anymore.
No, no,
you
can't.
I got a few of those in the closet, though. I'm waiting for them to come.
They're back.
Are they?
I don't like them big fellas, you know. They choke me.
Yeah. You can't hardly get those glasses either, those.
Not anymore. I gotta clean these, too, these days.
Getting a little foggy, yeah.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about Charlie Weaver.
All right, let's.
Did you invent Charlie Weaver?
Yeah, well, Charlie is a combination of my mother and an old uncle of mine. My mother's vagueness, she was beautiful. She never got names right, you know, and Charlie doesn't either.
Mm-hmm.
When he's talking about Leonard Boxer, Elsie Cracker, Byron Ogg, and some of his friends.
Some of the real biggies.
Yeah.
Of old time, sure.
And my mother used to come from, she always gave the wrong picture in the wrong theater and the wrong people in it. She, for years, she was in love with Eddie Nelson. Remember?
Oh, Eddie Nelson, mm-hmm. Sure. Uh-huh.
Very big.
Uh-huh.
And so that's where Charlie came from. Plus the fact I wanted a character that I could grow into, but not this fast.
Yeah.
Suddenly one day, a few weeks ago, I look in the mirror and there he is, you know, it's frightening.
Well, Charlie's still a young fella, and as a matter of fact, we have a little film clip of Charlie Weaver with Dave and Charlie, I guess it's about 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Here it
yeah.
is. Let's watch.
Mount Ivy, we don't do that, you know.
Eighth of an
inch. Back home in Mount Ivy.
What are they doing, Mount Ivy?
We use greased bear skins.
What?
For windows.
Greased bear skin?
Just stretch them and nail them on and grease them up good.
Oh.
Can't see out, but the light comes.
You mean that?
Charlie, here comes the train. Put the gloves on quick. Put the gloves on quick and grab the window.
Aye, aye.
Hurry up, Charlie. It's liable to fall right up the chairs.
Wait a minute.
Get your edge.
Wait a minute.
Hurry up. You got it? Oh, Charlie, if that had gotten broken, I don't know what I'd do. I don't have the money to buy a piece of glass for that window.
Here we are, we're back.
Yeah. Now,
20 years ago.
How about that?
20 years ago.
What happened to that young guy with the old hat on?
He's still around.
I think he's inside of me here, you know.
He is still around.
And do you know that Dave, my partner, Dave Willock, he used to look so much in those days like Frank Sinatra that people would stop us on the street and they'd say, Frank, can we have your autograph? And they'd say, who's the old guy?
Who's
there?
The guy with you?
Yeah.
And you just sort of...
Yeah, I just walk away, you know?
That's how it is when I go out with Kelly all the
time. I know.
Her and who's the guy with you? Who? Paul? Listen, how are things at Mount Ivy?
Oh, beautiful. Mama's just fine, yeah. And everybody back home will be very excited about this. Because we have television in Mount Ivy, you know. We don't have any sets. We have a station and a camera. It's all run by gas. I don't know if they're going to run it much longer.
Not much longer,
with the
I don't think.
Crisis
so.
Going
yeah,
on.
Yeah.
And everybody wants to go with Elsie Crack because she's the only girl that has oil in her hair in Mount Ivy. You know, there's no lack of oil there.
They got plenty. Wait, how come you're such a nice fella? You know, we've been walking. You just invited us right in, and you're
yeah,
nice
well.
And sweet and good-natured. And...
Good heavens, I hear my child crying.
Oh, really?
Is that mine?
I don't know.
I had a bicycle at one time, you know. I used to get around a lot. And Well, I just saw you going by, and I thought you'd like to come in. Maybe we talk
we
a little bit.
You know? Fess up. You wanted to meet Kel.
I wanted to meet. Yes, I did.
That's it. I mean, let's be candid
about the weather out here. Let's have a little talk about that.
Sorry about all that
Why
rain.
Why don't you call me? I can tell in my knees when it's going
to
rain.
What happens to your knees?
Oh, they get all choked up, you know? Mm. And I get...
Is that called water on the knee?
No, I used to have that, but I wore pumps for a while, and I got rid of it.
We are...
That's going back, isn't it?
Going back, you know, 25 years, the history of KNBC Channel 4 and NBC.
Now, that clip you saw was the thing that Dave and I dreamed up in the car on the way to the studio, and it became almost a classic, the thing with the plate glass.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, did you, you know, you are the master of the ad-lib, there's no question about it, but did you guys sort of work it out in your head about what you were going to do?
Yeah, we never had a script. We would just start winging it, and that's it.
No writers?
No writers.
They don't... That's one of the differences between television back then and comedy and today. Everything is sort of scripted for you now.
Yeah,
isn't it? I mean, there's no ad lib.
Not on Hollywood Squares.
No, not on Squares.
No, I wing it there.
Yeah, not on Squares.
But, you know, everybody was so afraid. They said, well, you know, can he last an hour? I used to do an hour and a half with Jack Parr, you know, every night. You know,
sure,
that's sitting out there throwing it back and forth, and he used to set me up. He's like Fat Jack Lemmon. He'd say, go in and get him, you know. And I'd come out. That's why I'm so old. I'm really only 22, you know. Inside, there's a little guy that's 22 years old.
But you are fast on your feet.
Someone put your faces at us.
Yeah, you know what? They're saying, leave him alone. We got to do Hollywood Squares. Enough already.
Oh. Yeah, they're calling you.
Oh, I have to go to work, folks.
Yes,
it's certainly been nice. Bye, George, and bye, Paul.
Cliff, thank you.
Bye, Kelly.
Thanks for
having
us. Oh,
Lord, it was nice seeing you.
Mm. You see, there you go again.
There goes my heart. This is a big one.
No.
We're going to go somewhere else around this.
We'll find somebody else to talk to.
Somebody else that I hope is going to be just as much fun as Cliff Arquette, and we shall be right back.
Ever since Marco Polo unlocked the mysteries of the Orient, long, elegant nails have been a symbol of beauty and glamour. But if you're one of those women who have problem nails that split, crack, or just won't grow, then here's great news. Now there's an amazing product called Long Nails that will change short, broken nails like these into beautiful, long, natural-looking nails that are even stronger than your own. Here's all you do. Simply put these forms around the tips of your fingers. Then just swirl the special long nail mixture over your nail and out onto the form. When your new nails are dry, remove the form and file and polish just like your natural nails. It's that easy. The complete Long Nails kit is available now for just $3, and it's guaranteed to give you longer, stronger, more elegant nails than you ever dreamed possible, or return to place of purchase for your money back.
Get Long Nails at thrifty drug and discount centers and all fine cosmetic counters.
Who backs you best? Say something except for tires just wears out on your new car during the first 12 months or 12,000 miles under normal use and service. Everyone covers the engine and drivetrain. What about plugs and points, shock absorbers, hoses and belts, light bulbs? Who aligns your wheels, tightens nuts and bolts, and has a plan for a free loan a car if guaranteed repairs take overnight? AMC Buyer Protection Plan. We back them better because we build them better.
Officers Reed and Malloy find action and danger on Adam 12, Tuesday at 8, 7 Central Time. Then next...
Banachek. I want him to find my horse.
Why Banachek?
Because I heard he was the best.
Maybe the horse did it. Maybe he was dead when they threw him in the stall. It's still murder.
Banachek must find a $5 million racehorse, which vanished right on the track. George Peppard stars as Banachek on the NBC Tuesday Mystery Movie at 8:30, 7:30 Central Time.
Did you know that KNBC last year put out 1,200 hours of public service programming? Of course, that includes 4 hours of regular news service every day.
We do 4 hours here every day, don't we?
Yep.
Yeah, that's incredible. And included in those 1,200 hours, one major documentary a month that's an hour long.
Always a new one.
14 public service programs a week on KNBC, Channel 4. And back in 1952, KNBH, when it was then in Hollywood, employed about, 50 to 60 people. And in 1974, Channel 4 KNBC, we have more than 250 folks working right here in this building.
Here is a gentleman.
Jackson.
that all of us know and love because he's an institution here at KNBC. As a matter of fact, Floyd is also celebrating his 25th anniversary. He came with the building, so to speak. Floyd Jackson, our shoeshine man. How are you, Floyd?
I'm Kelly. How are you?
How's business?
Good.
Tell us some of the people whose shoes you've shined over the last 25 years.
Oh, Bob Hope, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Jerry Lewis, all of them.
And you're writing a book, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm writing a book.
What's it going to be the name of it?
I Shine Them All.
As a matter of fact, you shined President Nixon's shoes one time, didn't you?
I did.
What, did he tip you?
He didn't give me anything.
The Secret Service took care of it.
Mr. Nixon doesn't pay. He has people that do that. Yeah. Okay. Talk to you later. You can shine these up in a little bit, okay? Because you're always mad at me because mine are always suede, right?
Right.
Bye, bye, Floyd.
Bye, bye.
Let's wander
down
the hall. Yeah.
What else we can find? Okay.
I guess this is the most famous studio here in KNBC's building.
Gotta be.
Studio One, it's called.
Number one.
The home of Bob Hope.
Built especially for a gentleman by the name of Bob Hope back in, I think it was 1952.
Well, this was the very first studio that was here this was here before the building was. And here's Bob, and he was here before the building was, too. How are you, Bob?
No, I was down at Sunset and Vine before this building was here.
Sure. As a matter of fact, you with NBC, I think, before it was even television, right?
Yeah, I think I came in around a little before Ed Sullivan.
Yeah.
Before they froze Ed Sullivan.
You've been with NBC, I think, about, 35 years now, Bob?
Yeah, I started in 38, and I've been with them ever since.
Did a little radio for about 10, 11 years?
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Pepsodent show. Most of the people I sold Pepsodent to are now using Paladin.
They've added all that stuff. What's the very first show that you did right here in this studio, Studio One?
Right here in this studio? Well, I did my first show, Kelly, in the New Amsterdam Theater in New York.
Oh, your very first show in television. That goes back even further than us.
That's right. That's right. And we did one season in New York. It was in Easter, 1950, and I had Bee Lilly and Doug Jr. And I don't think Dinah was on the first show. I think she was on the second show. But we had Max Liebman and his great chorus from the Saturday Night Show and a couple of the dancers. And I was really nervous. I was so nervous just before the show. I put my hand on the table to steady myself, and I got spirit messages.
Oh, really?
That's one of the jokes.
Did you levitate?
I made then.
Yeah.
Not now, but then. Let me ask you something. You couldn't say NBC without saying Bob Hope. As a matter of fact, your name has to be on the top of the list. Do you still get nervous when you go on, Bob?
No, I don't, Paul. I get concerned, you know,
that
everything will go right, and you're really worried about, I don't know, when you go on, you kind of, I kind of have the weight of the whole monologue on the show, and like when I go and do a guest shot, I do a great performance because it's free and ad-lib, you know, and you can climb around. But when you come out here, like with Diane Cannon, you're concerned about your guest stars, you know, and with Burt Reynolds and Deanne Warwick, who we're working with now.
Mm-hmm.
And you're concerned about getting it done for them, too, you know, getting it right.
Sure. The last special you did was just before Christmas, but it was Home this year.
That's
did that
right.
feel kind of funny?
Kind of strange, but yeah. Dolores invited the third division over just to, because I needed a fix.
The house is probably big enough to get them all in there, too, isn't it?
It must be great not to have to go over there, though.
Oh, it's wonderful, you know, to think that those kids are home. That's the greatest thing that ever happened.
Mm. You know, you've been rehearsing for this special that's coming up now, and when you come over here to KNBC, no matter who is here, sort of, well, let's face it, gets kicked out because this is your studio. And who is here is usually Johnny Carson for tonight and Tom Snyder for tomorrow. Did Tom and John speak to you?
John came in and sat in the audience the other day, and we asked him what garage he was working in.
Yeah, because he's got a pack bag and baggage to get down the hall.
Yeah, well, I have prior claim to this, and I will, you know, for a couple more years anyway.
I should think so. I guess if you and Dolores wanted to pack your bags and come in here and move in and stay for the rest of your lives, NBC would say, how do you want it decorated?
Yeah, but it'd be on my budget, I'm sure.
You got a special coming up, Bob, Thursday night, I think, on NBC, 9 o'clock?
Right.
And
absolutely on NBC.
Absolutely.
Wouldn't have it any other way.
Following Jack Benny, by the way.
Yeah.
This is Jack Benny's retirement special number two, right?
I think so. I think it is Jack's retiring again.
Yeah.
He retires so gracefully, doesn't he, with so many laughs.
Oh, he does it well. Yeah.
We just happen to have a piece of tape from that special that's coming up Thursday night on NBC at 9 o'clock. I think it's the sketch you did with Burt Reynolds.
Right. Papillon, whatever you want. Do a little satire on it.
Okay.
Hey, that guard here, what's he like?
Oh, he's wonderful.
Every day he tortures us and punishes us and slaps us and gouges us.
What's wonderful about that?
He's got great hands.
I'm gonna get it! Lunchtime!
Must be Tuesday.
A little like Jack in the Box, isn't it?
There you are.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. I hate it when you can't tell whether it's before or after.
This is Devil's Island, you know. It ain't Hamburger Hamlet.
It's no diner's place either.
Burt Reynolds and Bob Hope, two very good-looking guys doing a little sketch from...
He's an amazing guy. Isn't he fantastic? Really can get laughs, this guy.
Yeah.
You don't figure he's that good, but he's really marvelous. And he fooled me because he wasn't very good at rehearsals, and I kind of jacked him up. He said, don't worry. He said, real pro.
He was saving it, huh?
Yeah, he was saving it. It was awful good.
So that's going to be this coming up Thursday?
That's right.
9 o'clock right here on Channel 4.
Right. And Diane Cannon and Burt and I do Paper Moon, you know. We call it the paper caper. And she plays Tatum. It's a pretty hard character part for her to play a little girl.
Oh, yeah, because Tatum, I think, is 11, right?
Yeah, right. And Burt plays the banker, and I play Ryan O'Neill's part, the dad.
Oh,
you know,
yeah,
with a little mustache. I look like a con man. But it turned out pretty funny.
Great movie.
I read someplace that you're going to a lot of colleges now, aren't you?
I play a lot of colleges every year, yeah.
Mm. How do the kids receive Bob Hope?
They're wonderful. They're a great audience. And there's nothing you can do that's too smart for them, you know?
Oh, yeah.
They're really marvelous. They're right there. And I've had played colleges for the last 20 years. Purdue and Illinois and all those places. They're regular stops for me.
Did you get your degree yet?
I've had a few honorary degrees. You know that. Stolen.
Yeah. Honorary Oscar.
Illegitimately.
That's coming.
Yeah, right.
Bob, you know, you go way back to the beginnings, and you did early live television, and now you're doing tape. We all do tape. We can mess it up 8 times, and we do it till we get it right. But in the old days, you had to do it the first time, and all your mistakes hung out. What do you think was better?
I like the live. Live, because whenever you made a mistake, you could always ad lib on it. The audience knew about it, and you could capitalize on it, you know, and get maybe five minutes of screams on it, and it was great. Of course, the producer went right to the booby hatch on it, you know.
Yeah.
But it was great. For instance, we were on live radio with Bing one time, and we did a switch thing where he did the monologue, and I stood on stage. He did my monologue, and I mugged on every other joke, you know. So it ran over 2 minutes. So this was at Luke Field in Phoenix, and Bing was reading the last course, and Cap Staff was the producer, and he came out over Bing's shoulder and took 2 pages right out of his hand. And Bing went, what?
Oh, yeah.
Because there's no way you can finish, you know, and get on.
The
he talks about that. He'll do a half hour for you sometime.
How is Bing?
He's pretty good. He's pretty good. I hear he's going to be.
Yeah, he's coming along good.
Yeah, really.
Latest reports say
he'll be back squeezing oranges any day.
Oh, sure.
Which at his age is an emotional experience.
You know, this one is KNBC's number one. It's our big studio, and I guess we could say without any question that Bob Hope is number one here at KNBC. And I want to ask you, what do you attribute this fantastic durability to? You know, I mean, everybody loves you. They always have, and they always will. I know it's a tough question to ask, but see what you can do with it.
I tell you, I couldn't let this pass without giving my staff credit, you know, my writing staff. I think I've been very fortunate in assembling a group that really come up with the material, and at the last minute, you know, they'll come up, because we never stop working. And if we get with a Burt Reynolds sketch, why, there were some holes in it, and we say, get group 9 right away, and they come rushing in with the gems, you know, and we do that. And of course, I must give credit to my whole staff, my press guys and everything, for keeping it moving.
Well, that's good of you to give everybody else credit. Where do you get all your energy, Bob? You get a lot of golf, I know that, but...
And I lie about my age.
Yeah, and take vitamins like Bobby Riggs.
I do.
You ever get tired?
Oh, sure I do, Paul. Sure I get tired. But I take care of myself, and I walk a lot and try to, you know, get enough sleep. And I have a pretty good time. I get a lot of therapy out of entertaining. And you know, because we're in a very fortunate business. Like last night I was in Detroit doing a show for the guest house, which is for alcoholic members of the clergy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you can do things like that and get an audience of 1,700 who are really laughing, it does something for you. I know when you do a good show, you must appreciate
it.
And I watch, and you have a lot of fun, too, talking about the weather. Of course, the weather's pretty funny, isn't
it? That's funny right off. That's worth a laugh at, too.
Sometimes she's even right when she talks about the weather.
Not very often.
Right.
Bob, thank you. We love you. We always will, and we thank you so
great
much for making our show this afternoon.
back to rehearsal.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Bob.
Work hard.
You
bet. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Johnny Mathis has a way of turning pretty tunes into beautiful songs. Beautiful songs into bestsellers.
Hello, young lovers, whoever you are. A certain smile.
And now here's a new commemorative collection from Columbia House. The Early Years, two special albums filled with Johnny Mathis' greatest hits, songs that are as enjoyable today as they were yesterday.
Look at me, I'm as helpless as a kitten up a tree. Chances are...
Yes, here are two big albums filled with the Johnny Mathis classics, now specially priced at only $6.98.
What's it all about, Alfie?
But there's more. You'll also get this third exciting album with 10 of today's most popular songs. Songs like...
The first time ever I saw...
and many more. So altogether, you get three big albums with 30 of the greatest songs ever recorded by Johnny Mathis, all for the unbelievable low price of only $6.98. Also available on 8-track cartridges for only $10.98. Here's how to order yours right now.
To order, phone Richmond 91134 or save COD charges by sending $6.98 for albums, $10.98 for tapes to Johnny Mathis, Post Office Box 53, Los Angeles, California 90053. That's $6.98 for albums, $10.98 for tapes to Johnny Mathis, Post Office Box 53, Los Angeles, California 90053, or phone Richmond 91134.
Well, I guess that's about it. We sincerely hope you have enjoyed our little tour of KNBC in the past 25 years. We've had a lot of fun bringing it to you. The Cook's Tour didn't cost you a cent, right?
Right, and happy birthday, KNBC. The old gal is 25 years old now, and you know something, 25 is an awful good year.
Yeah, but she still looks pretty young, doesn't she?
She looks pretty good. So just sit back, relax, and let KNBC continue to serve you.
Okay, deal? Good. Thank you. Everybody.
Be sure to watch Bill Bird's Animal World.